Text for our message this morning is our gospel lesson from Luke 4, where we hear again these words of Jesus right at the end of the lesson. Jesus says, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to the other towns as well, for I was sent for this purpose." And this is the word of the Lord. Dear friends in Christ, every now and then somebody will say something and it just sticks. It's a catchy phrase, it's a memorable saying, it's a quotable quote, and these come really from all areas of life. For example, Allen Iverson, the former point guard for the Philadelphia 76ers, was once asked about his practice habits and how he had been missing practice lately, to which he responds in this lengthy tirade about how they are simply talking about practice. In just a portion of this interview, he says, "I mean, listen, we're talking about practice. Not a game, not a game, not a game. We're talking about practice. Not a game, not a game where I go out and I die for and I play every game like it's the last. No, not the game. We're talking about practice, man." And he goes on to say the word practice some 22 times, and towards the end of the interview, even the reporters are just, they can't even keep it together, they're laughing so much. So this is a quote that kind of continues to live on in the sports world even to this day. There are quotes, of course, that we see in the political landscape. There's one quote here from his inauguration speech where John F. Kennedy said these famous words, "And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." It's a quote that challenges and calls to service for the common good. It continues to call to us even this day to work on behalf of service of our citizens in this great land. Now, of course, there are also famous religious quotes as well. And so take this one memorable quote from St. Francis of Assisi, who said, "Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words." Now actually, St. Francis of Assisi didn't really say that. In fact, that's been kind of adapted over the years, over the course of time. But in fact, St. Francis said this kind of less than catchy phrase, "It is no use walking anywhere to preach unless our walking is our preaching." It is no use walking anywhere to preach unless our walking is our preaching. And so today in our lesson, we see that Jesus walking and preaching seem to line up quite well, don't they? Jesus not only talks the talk, but he walks the walk, and we see him as we recall what he's done so far in his earthly ministry. We saw him baptized in the Jordan River just a few weeks ago to identify with us, to be baptized into our experience. And we saw the image of the Trinity with the Father calling from heaven, his Son that is well pleased, and seeing the Holy Spirit descend upon him like a dove. We see Jesus help a family in a moment of social embarrassment when they had run out of wine at their wedding. And Jesus turns more than enough water into wine to easily last the rest of the party. This past week, we saw, of course, Jesus getting rejected at his hometown of Nazareth. They were excited at first when they heard great things about Jesus, but then they decide that it's time to reject him and even try to kill him when he says that his own people would reject him. And reject him they did. Jesus walking and preaching were not always met with a ton of great enthusiasm. But this week in our lesson, Jesus is being accepted again in places other than his hometown. And the big reason is this, and you probably caught this as it was mentioned a few times in the gospel lesson, that Jesus is one who is preaching and teaching with authority. Not like the scribes, not like the teachers of the law who kind of just philosophize and theologize, but he preaches in a way that impacts people. It packs a punch. It's something that they have never seen before. And they're amazed at him. Jesus isn't only teaching and preaching with authority, he's also casting out demons with authority. And they're coming up to him as he's teaching. They're even calling him and proclaiming him to be the Son of God, the Christ, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebukes them and prevents them from speaking any further because his time had not yet come. Not only this, the sick are healed. Jesus, of course, takes care of Simon Peter's mother-in-law. And then word gets out, and then all of a sudden, everyone in the city is bringing their sick to him. And with his gentle words and with his loving touch, they are healed. And these people, they don't want Jesus to leave. I mean, would any of us want Jesus to leave if we were experiencing his earthly ministry among us in this kind of personal way? I don't think we would. Because Jesus walking and preaching among them is good news. But what is not good news to these people is what Jesus says to them at the end of our lesson. He's gone out to a desolate place and they pursue him, trying to get him to stop, basically trying to keep him there to themselves. But he says that he must preach the good news to other towns as well. This is his mission. This is his purpose. Now, as we talk about Jesus' mission and Jesus' purpose, if that's Jesus' mission and purpose, to preach the good news, to bring that to other towns as well, then it's also our mission. It's also our purpose as the Christian church here on earth. But unfortunately, as we know, our walking and our preaching in our daily life are not always in step with Jesus as they should be. Now, one way that this happens, this is really kind of a strange thing, but it is something that happens. It's something that happens in our church body and others, and it's incredibly disheartening, and it completely misunderstands the heart and the ministry of Jesus. But you see, sometimes people will divide Christians into two different camps. They will divide them into what's called the confessional camp, and one camp is called the missional camp. Now, the confessional camp is one that would describe themselves as being fully committed to solid biblical truth and making sure biblical truth is expressed in worship. The missional camp, on the other hand, would describe themselves as being outward-looking and looking out to that particular community and seeing how they can share the gospel with other people at that time, and by any means possible. Now, what's the problem with this approach? I mean, they pitted the two against each other, right? It's saying that there really are two different types of Christians, those who confess the truth on one side, and those who care about reaching out to others on the other side. And as accusations fly from one camp to the other, those in the confessional camp will say that the missional camp doesn't care about the depth of our Christian faith and its teachings as they should. And the missional camp accuses the confessional camp about only caring about saying the right thing, but that they don't care about reaching out in love to other people, that they don't help people. Friends, this kind of attitude on both sides is exactly what St. Paul was talking about this morning in 1 Corinthians, wasn't he? He says this, "If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all the mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing." So this speaking here of Paul really is an indictment of both camps, isn't it? Paul is saying, if I say all the right things and know all the right things of Scripture, but if I don't have love, boy, am I way off base. And if, on the same side, if I sacrifice for others and kind of go all out for them, but don't have love, if I'm doing it just for myself to make myself look good or something like that, then I am just as off base. And so, dear friends, if I worship my Lord Jesus here at church, if I confess the creed, but if that doesn't impact how I live during the week, that's a problem. And on the flip side, if I do good and helpful things, but say it doesn't really matter what I believe or what my confession is, that's a problem too. And so as followers of Jesus, we don't try to divide ourselves into different camps, one that's confessional and one that's missional, one that preaches and one that walks, because they're not mutually exclusive. It's not one or the other, but it's both. In John 4, Jesus says those who are true worshipers will worship him in spirit and in truth. And in Matthew 28, he says that we would go and teach, go and make disciples of all nations. And so, in what we confess, we believe, teach, and confess who Jesus Christ is, how he's been crucified and risen for us. But at the same time, that leads us then to go with that message, to reach out to others in order that other people might be saved as well. So filled with the Holy Spirit, this leads us to look out to love and to serve our neighbors and to tell them about Jesus. And I still remember one time when I was in class at seminary, what one of my professors said. We were talking about kind of this connection between our confession and what we believe and the mission of the church. And he was saying how he really doesn't like that term, mission. One, because it makes him think of a place, you know, maybe you've heard of a place that's called, you know, the mission, or I'm going to help at the mission, or something like that. And two, for a more, I guess, practical reason, because it would make him hungry, as he would think about mission brand tortilla chips. So the word that he preferred instead of mission was sent. Sent. We are sent with our confession, and we are sent with Jesus Christ for us. And we are sent with Jesus Christ for others as well. So what does that look like, you know, as we're thinking about this in our Christian faith? Well, it looks like, as we can see right now, as Christians, as we join together in worship, confessing who our God is and what he's done for us. It looks like our times of Bible study, whether that's gathering together with other fellow Christians here at church or in our homes, or with our own personal study of the Word at times. It's also, the rest of the time, though, as we break from this holy huddle, as Pastor Kirk would like to call it, part of breaking the holy huddle, of course, does involve directly serving from church on behalf of others. For example, in this past year or so, we've collected to help Options for Women here in town. We've collected to help support Vicar Ben and Grace Vanderhyde in Sri Lanka, and also the Macedonia Lutheran Church in Kenya. All of these things are happening as a part of being at church and doing that together. But the rest of this breaking of the huddle happens as we go out into our various callings. We go out so that we can confess and lead to love and serve other people wherever it is that we go, whether it's at school as a teacher, whether it's down in the plant at Mississippi Lime, whether it's up at the steel mill, home as a parent, spouse, or child, or out in the community as a citizen. Wherever I go and I look to serve other people, that's what it's all about. These are opportunities for us also not just to serve, but also to use our words as Christians. Paul said in one of his epistles, "Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel of Jesus Christ." And so as Christians, we who have been transformed in Christ, as we say at the beginning of every service, we have the opportunity to share that hope with other people in our daily lives. A few years back, Pastor, then Vicar Andrew, led Holy Cross and Emmanuel through a workshop called Everyone His Witness, put out by Concordia Publishing House. And this tool emphasized a really helpful way for us to consider our witness in our everyday lives. And it follows the acronym LASSE. LASSE stands for Listen, Ask, Seek, Share, Invite, and Encourage. And this isn't meant to just be a simple linear progression, but all of these things can be done at any time to help us in sharing our faith with other people. And so that's what we do. We ask people to learn more about them. We listen to people and their life stories so that we can listen more. We seek points of connection. We share what God's Word has to say. We invite other people to kind of keep that conversation going. And we encourage people by following up with them. Just simply showing that we care is a means of evangelism in this way. So yes, we are talking about practice. We're talking about practicing our faith as we confess it and as we share it. We ask not simply what our church can do for us, but what we can do to serve in Jesus' church for his glory. And as we walk and preach through our actions and our words, we fulfill the purpose that Jesus has for us. In his name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in this Christ Jesus, to life eternal. Amen. Well, good morning. How are you doing this morning? Good? Are you waking up? Good. Me too. Sam, are you waking up? Yeah? Okay. Good. All right, well, we're all here this morning. It's good to see you. I found something again this morning at church. And it wasn't just, you know, some dusty old something upstairs or downstairs. But I found outside the church another rock. We had a rock here a few months ago on All Saints Day, and it said, well, now I'm trying to remember what it said. It said, "You are beautiful." And we talked about how we are beautiful new creatures in Christ because of what he's done for us. And this rock, what does that rock say? Can you read it? That's okay. It says, "Believe." And it's colored red, I'm guessing because we're getting close to Valentine's Day. And when we're getting close to Valentine's Day, we talk a lot about what? We talk about love. Yeah, we talk about love, right? And so love is something that we believe in, but we don't just believe in any kind of love or a love that is short or not good or things like that, but we believe in a wonderful kind of love. We believe in God's love. Do you remember that last week, you know that your grandma and grandpa, they celebrated an anniversary? It's 45 years, right? They just celebrated 45 years of being together because they love each other and they're married, and it's a wonderful blessing that your grandma and grandpa love each other so much. But did you know that God has loved us even way longer than that? God has loved us since before we were even born, since before we ever knew that we would be here. God loved us, and that's something we believe about him. We believe that he loves us so much, of course, that he sent Jesus for us to die on what Sam is clinging so closely here, to die on the cross, to rise from the dead for our forgiveness and for our life. And so that's what we believe about God. When we hear about his love for us, when we hear about his grace for us, we're reminded that nothing is greater than that, than his wonderful love for us. So will you join me in praying? Repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you
for your wonderful love.
Help us.
Help us.